Okay, joining us now is Dietmar Pichler. Am I pronouncing your name correctly?
Almost, yeah. Dietmar Pichler. Yeah.
Pichler. And you're in Austria, in Vienna. And the way that I found you is you responded to one of my tweets, a tweet about my new friend in Ukraine, Tatiana. And it turns out you are a disinformation analyst. You're fighting back against Russian disinformation against Ukraine. In what capacity? I see you are the founder of a social media company in Austria. What brings you to this? What makes you do this?
So first, my life was always about public health communication. So this is, as we all know, also something that is very affected by disinformation. And then also I love to travel Eastern Europe. Yeah, I have a lot of friends there in Poland, in Ukraine, and also in Russia, of course, and Belarus. And I traveled a lot before 2014. And then I came back to Vienna, and I saw there was a huge disinformation campaign from Russia against Ukraine. So basically what the Russians tried to demonize Ukrainians, to tell the world they are bad people, they are fascists, and they are really not worth supporting for our democratic world. And this was basically what happened between 2014 and now. And we see the result. Yeah. So what I saw is that for the domestic audience in Russia, the propaganda is even worse than what they show us. Yeah. They demonize, they tell their people that dehumanize basically. Yeah. They say they're all fascists. They have even stories that Ukrainians are crucifying children, Russian children. And this is so ridiculous. I want to tell one story. I have a friend, her name is Yevgenia, and she's from Eastern Ukraine. She's a Russian-speaking Ukrainian, and her mother was born in Russia. Yeah, so she's for sure not anti-Russian. Yeah, but she's Ukrainian, of course, because she lives there. Yeah, and they were shelling her house, and she had to flee several hundred kilometers. And she was calling her friends in Russia, and they told her, "We don't believe you. No, there is no shelling, there is no war. It's just a special operation." Yeah, and there are a lot of stories. So sometimes even their own mothers in or fathers, when they are in Russia, they don't believe their own children when they tell them about the war. It's heartbreaking.
It is heartbreaking. In fact, Tatiana's father is estranged from his family, but he lives in Russia and does not believe her. Does not believe this is going on. Look, we've seen this here in the States. You know, during Trump's reign of terror, all he did was lie. And Putin and Trump are two sides of the same coin, and employing the same playbook, lying, blatantly lying to people, and many of them just believe him. And it's tragic.
Yeah, absolutely. And some people tried, if they were from Ukraine, and they tried to contact the Russian friends, and they were posting on social media. So I even analyzed the things which was on Russian social media. And the problem is that if you have a profile there, and if you try to speak about the war, which is not even allowed to call war, you know, they call it special operation, then your profile got deleted. Yeah, it got banned and blocked. Yeah, so it's very, very difficult to break through to this wall. Yeah. And they created a new Berlin Wall or a new Iron Curtain of disinformation there. And it's really like Putin is trying to create a kind of North Korea. Yeah? So all the channels got banned. Facebook is blocked. Yeah? So it's very, very, very difficult. But what I find equally problematic is that he's trying also to convince our democratic world that the Ukrainians are bad and somehow they deserve this punishment. And this is very dangerous because people need our support. In Vienna, we have already thousands of refugees from Ukraine. In Poland, there are already hundreds of thousands, and millions are going to come. And of course, they need our help, and Ukraine as well. They need supplies and everything. So, and Putin tries to divide us. So he attacks Europe since 2014. He loves populist movements. He loves the especially the far right. He has very close connections to parties. Sometimes they have even agreements. And about the Donald Trump election and president election, I don't need to educate you because you know everything.
Know. Well, and along those lines, Dietmar, you put a thread up on Twitter trying to correct some of these falsehoods, some of these, some of this disinformation that Russia has been pushing so that people know the truth. So if you don't mind, would you tell us what you think is so important that we over here and the rest of the world needs to know, starting with there never was a civil war or ethnic conflict in Ukraine?
Yes, I think this is the most important thing. There is no ethnic conflict in Ukraine because Ukrainians are as mixed as you can imagine. Mm-hmm. So I hardly find a Ukrainian who has not a babushka, which means grandmother, which is from Russia. So mm-hmm. they have the family context, like you know, and it's not about ethnicity. So this is not, it doesn't matter. People, they don't talk about it. It doesn't matter because they are close culturally, but not politically. Politically, they have their own identity because they choose democracy. Yeah? It's not perfect in Ukraine, but they decided to develop. And this is the difference. And what I find very disturbing when I hear, and even Austrian people or German people or Europeans or some Americans tell me, yeah, but in Kyiv, you cannot speak Russian. It's banned. That's really a bland lie. When I was in Kyiv, I think 30 times or more often, and still you hear Russian even more often than Ukrainian. Yeah, so this is like a lingua franca there. Yeah, so it's completely normal to speak Russian. And President Zelensky had a TV series where he was an actor playing a president, and this TV series was also mostly in Russian language and not Ukrainian. Yeah, so there were only parts in Ukrainian. In his daily life, in the TV series, he spoke Russian. So, and the former minister of foreign affairs from Ukraine was a man born in Russia, raised in Russia, studied in Moscow, and then left Russia to live in Ukraine. So you see, I could tell you so many examples that this is a lie, but still people believe in it. Yeah? And yeah, but we should not give up because I think if you have the examples and if you can show it, for instance, I would like to mention one more. There's a Russian singer, Russian peace singer, and he was in Ukrainian television, like we today, via Zoom. He was connected and he was singing a song in Russian. He was speaking to the moderators in Russian. They replied in Russian. Right. So there is no language ban. It's actually not an issue. It's just a Russian lie.
Right. I figured that. I've not spent much time over there, but I did adopt my daughter from Kazakhstan. And I know, look, Kazakhstan, they speak Kazakh, but they also speak Russian. I learned a bit of Russian before I went there. And it's widely, and I'm guessing it's probably the same in Ukraine. This is a lie. This is disinformation that the Russians are putting out to, I guess, to turn the world against Ukraine. Then your third one is the founders of the so-called separatist republics were actually Russian nationalists from Moscow, not coal miners from Donbas.
Yeah, I think this is very important to mention. There are two guys, Igor Kirkin and Alexander Borodai, and they were both from Moscow. They have a background from the intelligence service. They have a military background. They were already warlords in several other conflicts where Russia was involved. They are nationalists. I mean, we could call them fascists. They were also authors. They were writing for a magazine called Savtra, which means the morning or tomorrow, and which is a nationalistic magazine where they put all their imperialistic ideas. Yeah, so they had nothing to do with Donbass, actually. Of course, they found some allies, but if you take a look what they published themselves, Igor Girkin said, I pulled the trigger, I started the war there, and I was not even able to find 1,000 fighters, 1,000 warriors joining my cause. So this was the moment when so many so-called tourists from Russia came, or lost soldiers, and were supporting the so-called separatist republics. Yeah? But it's very mixed, and it's totally not like the Russian narratives wants to tell us. And what also is very important is so-called breakaway republics. They tried to expand. They wanted to create a region called Novorossiya, which is a historical imperial Russian thing in the also on the Black Sea. And they wanted to make it much bigger. And the Ukrainian tried to defend against this. And Russia turned it like they were attacking. Yeah. So this is also a lie.
Wow. So you've been compiling basically a list of these falsehoods, these lies that they've been pushing to try to justify their invasion. It's Putin, right? This all goes back to Vladimir Putin, right?
Yes, it goes back to Vladimir Putin, but also he has some kind of ideology input, for instance, from a guy called Alexander Dugin. He is also a far-right philosopher. He has his dreams about a big Russian empire, and it's very... I would not call it conservative. It's very far right based. Mm-hmm. So it's traditional values. They say they want to protect traditional values against what they call gay Europe or gay Europa. Yeah. So because in Europe we have of course a very more liberal progressive approach in social policy and
thank you for that.
Yeah, and they want to give another picture. And this is why the far right is supporting Putin so much, because they see him as a kind of saint. Yeah, he is protecting the family values, the traditional values, but actually he's sending young boys into a war which is based on lies.
It's just a horrible situation. And the really sad thing is that propaganda campaign is working for a lot of people. I found out that there is a allegedly progressive member of Congress who is believing the Russian narrative, and it's appalling to me. What else are we misinformed about? What else have we been told that is actually not right?
I want to answer to what you mentioned before about progressives supporting these narratives. I think they are basically my target group in educating, because the far right, I think it's senseless because they agree with his policy, they agree with his with people like Dugin or Girkin, and their nationalistic view, and they like it. I think they would also not agree to get invaded, but from their point of view, they see Putin as strong leader or something traditional. But progressives that I think, or centric people that are falling for Russian disinformation, this is my target group. And these are the people I want to talk about, because I know Ukraine well. I also have been a lot of times to Russia. And what I have seen there, nationalistic movements, they were even recruiting people for the war in Donbass on the street and telling that people in Kiev and in Ukraine are bad. So this was really very bad. What else should we know? I think the language issue is the most important. Mm. What we also should take into account is that Putin wants to punish Ukraine because he doesn't believe it's a real country. So he says they have no tradition of statehood, which is false. He says that they are not independent. They are not. They have no right, basically no right to exist. What is completely wrong? And he doesn't accept a democratic society in his neighborhood. And this is why Belarus, for instance, this is a puppet state. Yeah, so President Lukashenko is a full-scale dictator, which is a puppet from Vladimir Putin. And when he says that there is a security threat from Ukraine towards Russia, this is completely ridiculous, because it's a much smaller country, a much smaller military, and there was never any kind of security threat against the Russian Federation.
And can you address Putin's claim that he's doing this to, in his words, denazify Ukraine?
Yeah, that's most ridiculous because President Zelensky, he's, first of all, he's from an eastern part from Ukraine. Mm-hmm. He's a Russian-speaking Ukrainian. You can also see it in the TV series. It's almost in Russian. He had even to train, when he became president, some people had doubts because he had to train his Ukrainian because he was more fluent
in Russian.
In daily life, he was a Russian speaker. Yeah? So, and he has Jewish heritage. Yep. Yeah. So it's completely ridiculous. Yeah? And also the other people. Of course, there are far-right parties in Ukraine as well with 2.38% at the elections. So they have absolutely nothing to say in politics. I wish in Austria we had that result. And
Well, I thank you for doing this. I know you're very visible on Twitter, and you're telling any journalists or anybody who is reporting on the situation over there that what you do is you debunk this disinformation and that you are making yourself available to present facts. And I thank you for that, because there's a lot of disinformation out there, and we need to set people straight on what's going on. What's going on is atrocious. It's simply atrocious.
Yeah, the problem is that a lot of journalists, they have to cover a lot of topics. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so they, and Ukraine is a complex thing. Yeah, so it's true that in the East they speak more Russian, but it doesn't mean that they are Russian or that they want to be separatists. There was a survey, for instance, for the city of Odessa, and it's very Russian-speaking city, and they have a toy store street, and they have everything which is connected to Russian culture, basically. But the people feel Ukrainian, and they made a survey if they want to be separatists, and only 3% of the population wanted to break away. The others, 97%, felt as Ukrainians. Yeah? So I think about some states in the United States, maybe more people would be separatists than 3%, yeah? Or also in Austria or other countries. Yeah. So that is what we need to understand about Ukraine, that language is not a political view. It doesn't mean anything at all.
It's a mode of communication. That's what language is. All right. Well, Dietmar Pichler, if I got that right, thank you so much. It's a big world, but it's a very small world. And as I'm reaching out across oceans to talk with both you and my friend Tatiana in Ukraine, who is just enduring atrocities. I'm shocked with what's going on. Her family, she and her husband left Kyiv, where they own a hostel, hotel. And they went to a remote, what she described as a remote village, where for a few days it was quiet. And then when I awoke to the news this morning that Putin's forces were bombing these other regions that they hadn't been in before, and she had sent me a map so I knew where they were, and I thought, oh God, that looks like just where they are. And sure enough, it's where they are. And now they're going to have to leave again. This shouldn't be happening. The fact that the world is standing still and letting this madman exterminate the Ukrainian people in this manner is just, it's physically upsetting. I hope this ends soon. Thank you for trying to inform people, because that's what we can do, is spread truth. And that's what I'm trying to do. And obviously you are too, and I appreciate it.
Yeah, that's very important. I want to invest most of my time into this issue. Today I met people from the refugee center, and I gave them some stuff, and I also helped them in that way. But Austrians are doing a good job in that. But I think disinformation is, for me, it's like I have a duty because I am informed. It's just a coincidence, yeah? And now it's very important to... And thank you also for reaching out and supporting and taking care on the other side of the ocean.
I wish I could do more. So what I can do is stay in touch with one person over there and share her story. And when she's attacked mercilessly by someone in this country, I can play mama bear because my claws came out. Dietmar, thank you so much. And please stay in touch. I am following you on Twitter. You're Dietmar Pichler One. I will put a link to it on the blog where I post today's show, so people can follow you as well and stay informed. Thank you. Thank you.
Thanks for having me. Good night. Good afternoon.
Well, good night. I know it's later over there. Thank you again.